Welcome back, friends. This is the first lecture of the basic concepts of physiology lecture series. In this video tutorial, we'll discuss about the concepts of homeostasis in physiology. So let's begin the topic. First, we'll understand what is homeostasis. So it can be defined as the maintenance of constant internal physiological conditions with the ever-changing environmental factors to allow the proper functioning of the body is called homeostasis. The term homeostasis was coined by Walter Cannon, and the word homeostasis is derived from two Greek words, homeo, that means similar, and stasis, that means stable. Thus, homeostasis actually refers to the stability, balance, and equilibrium within a cell or the body. And this is very much important for the normal functioning of the body. Homeostasis is basically a core concept necessary for understanding many regulatory mechanisms in physiology and in animals, including human. The internal environment must have certain conditions within tolerable limits to continue the healthy functioning of the body. Here, this term tolerable limits is very much important, because homeostasis works only under this tolerable limits. If suppose someone set an animal on fire, that will be above the tolerable limits, and in that condition you cannot justify homeostasis in that particular organism. Homeostasis is regulated by different mechanisms such as osmoregulation, thermoregulation, chemical regulation, etc. by different systems of the body, like the respiratory system, digestive system, nervous system, urinary system, and so on. These systems maintain the stability of the body by releasing the stimulus in the form of either chemical message or hormones, or in the form of neural coordination. The endocrine system has a regulatory effect on other organ systems in the human body. In the muscular system, hormones adjust the muscle metabolism and energy production and growth of the muscles. In the nervous system, hormones affect the neural metabolism and regulate the fluid and ion concentration, and help with the help of this reproductive hormone, it can influence the development of brain. Homeostasis is regulated by three different mechanisms, and they are osmoregulation, that is the maintenance of constant osmotic pressure in the body fluid of an organism by control of water and salt concentration. Whereas thermoregulation implies the process that allows the body to maintain a constant core internal temperature. Chemical regulation is the substances called hormones are produced by well-defined group of cells or glands, and are either diffused or carried by the blood in case of endocrine glands to other areas of the body, where they act on target cells and influence the metabolism or induce the synthesis of other substances to maintain the homeostasis. So these three, osmoregulation, thermoregulation, and chemical regulation, are the three pillars to maintain the homeostasis in an organism. These mechanisms are performed in the body by various systems of the body. These are the different systems of the body that help in maintaining homeostasis and maintain a physiological function in a coordinated fashion. The stimulus is generated by some of the glands or the neurons, and the cells act accordingly to maintain the proper functioning of the cell and as a whole of the body. Thus, feedback mechanism work and maintain the cells to meet the set point when to switch on and when to switch off a particular physiological response. Now, what is this set point? This set point is done by feedback regulation mechanisms. So, what is feedback regulation? Hormones regulate the activity of body cells. The release of hormones into the blood is controlled by a stimulus, and the response to stimulus changes in the internal conditions and itself may become a new stimulus, and this self-adjusting mechanism of the internal system is actually called as the feedback regulation. The feedback regulation can be of two types, the positive feedback regulation and the negative feedback regulation. So let's consider the positive feedback regulation first. positive feedback regulation is basically less common in the biological system. Positive feedback acts to speed up the direction of change of a physiological process. As for example, you can take the lactation or milk production. When the baby starts sucking, the nerves message is sent from the mammary gland to the brain, which causes the hormone prolactin to be synthesized and secreted. As a result, the release of prolactin increases, and it is directly proportional to the suckling stimulus produced by the baby and the production of milk. Here in this diagram you can see here is the suckling stimulus by the baby that will induce the hypothalamus. It will help the pituitary gland to secrete the prolactin hormone as well as the oxytocin hormone. Prolactin is responsible for the production of milk in the mammary gland, whereas oxytocin helps in secretion of the milk. So as the suckling stimulus by the baby increases, there will be more and more production of prolactin and oxytocin, and they will help in production and secretion of milk. So this is a example of positive feedback regulation. Now we'll discuss the negative feedback regulation. Negative feedback is most common feedback loop in the biological system. It maintains the homeostatic balance. The system basically acts to the reverse the direction of change of a physiological process to maintain the response constant. We can take the first example as when the carbon dioxide level increases in the air which we breathe, the lungs are signaled to exhale carbon dioxide more, which causes increase in the breathing rate, and carbon dioxide level is balanced, and then lungs will function normally. In the second example, you can take the example of thermoregulation. When the body temperature increases, then automatically the receptors present in the skin and hypothalamus senses that core body temperature and triggers a command from the brain which makes skin to sweat. The blood vessels near the skin surface will dilate, and that helps to decrease the body temperature through latent heat. And this is called thermoregulation, and this also comes under the negative feedback loop system. Now here you can see the example in the diagrammatic form. Here carbon dioxide increase in the breathing air will stimulate the lung to start exhaling more and more carbon dioxide. It will ultimately reduce the carbon dioxide level and induce the proper functioning of the lungs. If the temperature of the body, core body temperature increases, then it will send message to the receptors present in the skin and hypothalamus that will ultimately send message to the skin sweat gland to release more and more sweat. As a result, the body temperature decreases. Now, the organisms can be classified based on their ability to maintain the homeostasis. Broadly, the organisms can be classified into three categories. First are the regulators. Regulators are those organisms that can maintain their internal environmental conditions with the ever-changing environmental conditions. Okay, internal environment will be constant as compared to the external environmental conditions, and that do not migrate to another place, like the birds, mammals are the examples of these regulators. We can take the example of homeotherms or warm-blooded organisms. These organisms can maintain their body temperature constant with any change in the environment. Conformers, the second category, are the organisms that are required to migrate to new locations in order to maintain their homeostasis. Examples are lizard, fish and insects are the example of conformers. We can also take the example of poikilotherms in broad term, or cold-blooded organisms. These organisms cannot maintain their core body temperature with the change in the environmental temperature. The third category is the partial regulator. These are the organisms which can change their body temperature in relation to the environment. The small animals like squirrels, shrew are the examples of partial regulators. Here we can take also example of ground squirrels, that they can maintain the body temperature up to certain limits. This is the diagrammatic representation of different organisms in response to the environmental conditions. In the y-axis you can see the internal environmental condition, and on the x-axis you can see the external environmental condition. For the regulators, there is no change. With the change in the external condition, there is no change in the internal level. So it is just parallel to this x-axis. If we consider the conformers, there is constant change in the internal level with the change in the external environmental condition. Whereas in case of partial regulator, they can maintain their conditions up to certain limit, but after that they cannot maintain their internal body conditions. Now, what is the need for physiological homeostasis? Basically, physiological homeostasis help to maintain the concentration of carbon dioxide and oxygen in the body, pH and ion balance, concentration of nutrients and waste products, concentration of salt and electrolytes, volume and pressure of extracellular fluids, metabolic heat generation, and so on. What are the advantages of homeostasis? Basically, homeostasis gives an organism with survival advantage because it helps an animal to adapt to a changing environment. It can deal with the temperature difference in the environment through thermoregulation. Second, the body will attempt to maintain a constant desired level of a factor to achieve homeostasis. However, it can only work up to the tolerable limits. Organisms can adapt to the changing environments and thus can occupy different ecological niches, hence reducing competition that will allow more and more survival chances. Under homeostasis, an organism is able to inhabit successfully and reproduce optimally, that increases the survival of species. So, this is all about the concept of homeostasis. Thank you for watching.